Hi everyone, my name is Kate McCarthy and I'm a livestock officer with Northwest Local Land Services, and we're just doing a series of case studies across the Northwest region with producers talking about some of the strategies they used over the drought and how they continue to use those strategies even in a good season. So today I'm here with Ian Gardner, who's a producer in Wean, which is just near Gunnedah. And we're just going to talk about some of the strategies he's used for his sheep enterprise. So thanks for joining us, Ian. How big's the place out here, Ian?
We've got about 4,500 acres we lease.
Yep.
In two places, yeah.
Yep. And we're talking about the sheep side of things. How many sheep, like, what do you tend to run at, and what did you run at during the drought?
Before the drought, we started with about sort of 1,800 ewes.
Yep.
And 100 cows, and then, through it, we got back to about 1,200 ewes.
Yep.
Just trade cattle in after that, so.
Yep.
Yeah.
And as you can probably see, we're just in Ian's setup. He's got a feedlot set up, and he used that as a mechanism during the drought, but continues to use that when the market and timing is right. So what were some of the things start with your ewes, Ian, what you did managing your ewes during the drought?
We started with the advantage feeders in the paddock, but we had issues with the shy feeders eating, so we went to trail feeding.
Yep.
Just mainly straight barley and a bit of lime.
Yep.
But we did manage to get most of our ewes back in lamb the whole way through. So every 8 months, those Dorper ewes were still joined.
Yep.
And we managed to get about 1,200 of them through the drought and produce the whole way through. So
yep.
Yeah, that was the main thing.
Yeah, and I didn't mention, but you mostly run Dorpers.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep. So how many Dorpers were you running at the time?
Ewes. We started with about 1,800 and got back to about 1,200, and they were only culled on what didn't go in lamb pretty well.
Yep.
Everything else kept producing.
Yep. And tell us about what the setup here and how this came about and what you used it for in the drought and what you use it for now.
Well, we had an original setup with self feeders, where we sort of had capacity to feed probably 1,000 to 1,200 lambs. And we were using that as a seasonal thing, or basically, when we needed to, an opportunity lot. And through the drought, obviously, we were early weaning our lambs at 8 weeks and putting them straight on feed because we had nothing else for them to go and do.
Yep.
So we decided to make it a bit easier and extend the sort of feed lot. And at the moment, we can do sort of 2,500 with the upgrades, and we've got two more pens to build will get us up to close to 3,000.
Yep.
The main thing was making it easier. So we'd been looking at these shepherd auto feeders for a fair while, and that was the main go forward, to basically make the induction more effective and easier.
Yep.
Less labour intensive and trying it more, the shy feeders on, and it also sort of, it lets us be flexible, I suppose, in going forward, whether we use them just for feedlotting or feeding ewes or feeding maiden ewes or body condition score, getting sheep up to that sort of thing. So.
Yep. During the drought, Local Land Services ran a series of workshops around confinement feeding, and although Ian uses this also for a feedlot setup, I think there was lots of opportunities in confinement feeding, and even in a good season continues to be. This is a fence we've just ran through, before we started filming the setup, and it's a good setup. Could you tell us about what we've got here and how it sort of works for you, like you set up through backgrounding and everything?
The lambs come onto the, in a normal season you'd background them in the paddock and get them trail feeding grain first, or imprinting. And then they come onto these feeders, and the feeders, you can set the timer, so they feed them at certain intervals. And over a 10-day period, we build them up from probably 100 grams to, a kilo and a half.
Yep.
So they go through this system where they're on the auto feeders, which feeds them automatically at certain intervals, depending on what timers you put in. And then from there, they go into the self-feeding pens and finish on the self-feeders, and we keep the inductees coming in onto these.
Yep. What was your ration? What do you tend to, what do you tend to include in your rations?
Pretty much it's 15% of a rolled lupin, 80% barley, and 5% of a Protect S feedlot additive pellet is what we're putting in. So.
Yeah, and just like I suppose with confinement feeding, one of the, well, you know, if we are looking at a confinement feeding setup, one of the main benefits which should be aimed for is to save labour rather than making it harder for yourself. It'd be good to make it easier. And so how's, like, from this side of things, how's this helped you? Like, we're talking about it before, there's a camera set up for when you're away from the system, there's a timing so you can time when the feed comes in and that sort of stuff. You can manage, you know, the amount of feed coming in and out on the under the feeding troughs there. So how's it been a labour saving?
Oh, it's huge on labour. Like, we can mix up 10 tonne in the silos, and as an induction, they'll last 3 to 4 weeks.
Yeah.
You know, probably more. So the old method of bucket feeding twice a day or three times a day, and you're doing that for 10 days, so you're up here morning and night, plus cleaning water troughs in between. This way you come up, clean the water troughs, change the timer, make sure for the first 3 days you're making sure the lambs are coming and eating and pulling out your shy feeders, and then after that you don't really have to be. It sends you an SMS when your machine turns on and off, so you know it's working, and you can check via phone if you're not here. Not that we did that, we were here the whole time, but just basically come up in the morning and then reset, so you might go from 5 feeds to 7 feeds the next day or something like that, and you set it that night and then clean your troughs in the morning and go again.
So. Yeah. What about roughage? Like, you've obviously got your hay feeders set up around. Like, what about roughage? How much did that get included in the ration?
Well, it's not in the ration. We ad-lib in the paddock.
Yeah,
right. in the pen.
Yeah,
We probably didn't do enough roughage this season because we didn't have it, or enough good roughage.
Yeah.
But then when they go under the... We'll put straw in the induction pens, and then when they go under the... on the other pens, the roughage get cut out altogether. So,
Yeah, very good. Run us through, like you were telling me before, you changed your watering setup. Run us through, like, how that's worked for you and what you think of that.
Yeah, well, the watering setup we had troughs that were very hard to clean out, and they were too big. We thought originally you needed a fair bit of water to keep it cool, but it's not the case. A sort of smaller amount of water and more pressure and more volume coming through, so they got fresh water all the times, seems to be the secret. So we changed from the old troughs to, we made ones out of PVC, and then I cleaned them with a chimney sweep. It takes literally about less than a minute to clean a trough out.
Yep.
So you tend to do it more regularly.
Yep.
As you're walking around checking your pens in the morning, it's no effort at all.
Yep.
So it's definitely made a big difference, the water.
Yeah, and like another thing too is walking around, like the gradient of where you've set up and the type of country that you've set your feedlot up. Like, obviously there's some factors that you probably need to take in, even in it, like especially in a good season, if we do get rain, you need to be able to avoid like really boggy, muddy areas. So like had this always been here, or?
Well, the original setup was here before we got here, but that hasn't been used for about 20 years, but they'd set up on a pretty good hill.
Yeah.
I mean, we joked about it in the drought that this is the hardest bit of country on the whole place, and it was the only thing making us any money, so it's a pretty hard gravelly little hill, but it's perfect for the feedlot.
Yeah.
We were worried about exposure early, but we've never had an issue with it. So, been lucky in that regard.
Yep. And, like, just for, like, people listening in, you know, if we do come into a drought again, or any, you know, what piece of advice would you give to people around feedlotting, confinement feeding in that type of situation?
Well, I'd change a few things. I'd confinement feed all our ewes this time for sure.
Yep.
There's not much point having them run around the paddocks.
Yep.
Trampling them, and it's a lot, like you said, it saves labour having them all in one place. You're not driving around, like we do it out of a grouper on a truck.
Yep.
And it'd be a lot simpler, especially if you didn't have to go in the pens as well.
Yep.
It has taught some of our ewes some bad habits with pushing through fences and stuff like that too, when they just decided they'd had enough.
Yep.
I'd definitely change that. Early weaning, something that we definitely took out of the drought, and we're still doing.
Yep.
We could probably get down to 6 weeks, but we're weaning at 8 weeks of age when the youngest lamb's 8 weeks.
Yep.
And it doesn't affect them at all.
Yep.
Really doesn't. Like, I've got weaned Dorper lambs down here that look as good as any Dorper lambs I've ever had.
Yep.
The ewes are fat, and they're getting scanned on Friday again, so they got joined in a 7-month period, and it allows them to go back in, and they're probably body condition score of 4 now.
Yep.
As long as you've got the feed, but even without the feed, I mean, it's cheaper to feed two of them separately than feed one together.
Yep.
And when you do feed the whole unit together, you tend to get a big tail in your lamb.
Yep. So how like with just interesting, like with your early weaning, how do you go, like how did you go about that, and how do you like continue to go about that, I guess, now?
Oh, we just yard wean them, usually only for 3 days.
Yep.
They just get hay in the yard.
Yep.
And that's probably something we could work on too, and probably getting them to eat, learn to eat, but it's hard with the setup in our yards. But that's the other advantage of this. Then we draft onto, through the drought, we drafted them into lots of 300.
Yep.
And then so there's 150 a pen come into here, the lead of them, and the tail went into a paddock, and we trail fed them out of the truck trying to get them to learn to eat at the same time, and then followed them through here. So.
Yep. Yeah, righto. And yeah, just one other thing, I suppose it's talked about a lot, but like with the feedlotting side of things, like the cost associated, you know, does it in the right with matching the market, is it something that you've seen value in?
Definitely through the drought.
Yeah.
We were buying lambs in also, and there was between $30 and $50 in those lambs bought in that period. So yeah, it was worthwhile. We did have, you've got to lower your sights a little bit too, feeding them from 8 weeks though too, that you're not going to get them to 60 kilos live weight or, you know, 30 kilos dead. We sort of had to lower that they were getting turned off between 22 and 24 kilos dead, but there was still money in doing it. It was costing us $60 a head to feed them, and probably worth $50 as weaners, and we're still getting, I think we averaged $165 through that period.
Oh, well, yeah, thanks for having a chat to us, Ian. Really appreciate it, and hopefully people listening in have got some value from hearing what Ian had to say, seeing the setup, and yeah, for all our other case studies. Hopefully we can take some lessons out of it, and well, hopefully we don't have to deal with it too soon, but if we do, we've got some direction. So thanks for that, Ian.
No worries. Thank you.